Tarun. So thank you very much, Tarun. It's a real pleasure to be kind of the science conversation among this very distinguished audience. So I would like to thank the Super Science Foundation, Yuri Chinkup, who's not here on the image, for hosting this event. Also Michael Douglas and Ashwin, who are both on our advisory board of ICTP, who are really leading this effort to organize this event, and for Edward to agree and to come all the way from Princeton to say a few words about ICTP. Yeah. And of course, for all of you, from taking time and really making the effort to come here. So thank you very much. So this meeting is intended as a launch of the ICTP global community to start a conversation about the current relevance of this very important mission of ICTP and what ICTP can do in the coming years. So many of you here are very closely familiar with ICTP, but there are others who have not only heard about ICTP, so I just want to introduce you very quickly. ICTP was founded by the Nobel laureate Abdus Salam, originally from Pakistan, in 1964. Robert Oppenheimer was the first chair of our scientific council, and so we were closely linked with the International Atomic Energy Agency in the beginning. And now we are governed by a tripartite agreement between the government of Italy, IAEA, and UNESCO, and we are a Category 1 center of UNESCO. We will be celebrating our 60th anniversary next year. It's a really appropriate occasion to do some retrospection about the institutional direction. I just want to say that I'm very happy that Ambassador John Averico, from the Permanent Delegation of Italy to the UN, Vice Council Member of Italy to New York, Mammanam, and representative of UNESCO to the UN, Elliot Lichtenberg. They are present here, so I just want to take this occasion to say that ICTP is very grateful to the support of all the three stakeholders of ICTP. So ICTP is located, as I said, in a very beautiful location in the Adriatic Sea, the Miramare Park. We are happy for the Italian hospitality there. And it has given rise to the Trieste Science System. It's really quite a remarkable ecosystem of science institutes. And as a result, the city of Trieste is recognized as the city of science in Europe. And it's quite an international city, which I think reflects the spirit of ICTP, I would say. And let me now, before giving the word to Edward, just summarize the three main pillars of ICTP's mission. One is excellence, as you said, inclusion, and cooperation. These are the three pillars. Excellence to conduct scientific research at really of an highest caliber. Yeah. Inclusion to make advanced science globally available, overcoming the barriers of not only gender and, of course, gender and ethnicity, but equally importantly, geography and economics, which often can be much bigger barriers. And to promote international cooperation through science. These are our three pillars of our way. And all these three are equally important and interdependent, and I think increasingly more relevant today. So I think the importance of ICTP is what I want to bring out. And we have an impressive track record of delivering on this mission very effectively. And I believe that this core strength of ICTP is going to be, has a great potential to grow in the coming years, which can have a substantial role in that. So it's also an honor to have Edward now joining us today. He's of course someone who cares deeply about the mission of ICTP and what ICTP stands for. I had the good fortune of learning general relativity and string theory from him. We also wrote a paper together. I would request him to say a few words about his experiences.
Well, thank you so much, Atish. Thanks as well for the Science Foundation for hosting us this year. I was a rather regular visitor at the ICTP in the late 70s and the 80s, roughly in the first decade after I got my PhD. And I can say it was a very intense scientific atmosphere, especially with Atish Salam running things and many other people, the Irish Patini and John Strandy and many others. A lot of great work had been done there, pioneering work on grandification, pioneering mobile supersymmetry many elements. I myself brought one of my more famous mercies, the ICTP. That was now the electric charger of a magnetic arc. So it was very about memorable time listening to ICTP guilds. We enjoyed very much the intense atmosphere and science.
And I think so I can also say in my own career, ICTP was of great importance. I first came to ICTP when I just graduated Princeton to attend a major conference, and that's when I first met Salam. It was a great experience. But then I returned to ICTP again and again to lecture there, you know, conferences, to give seminars. Then I was a staff associate, even when I was a professor at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Mumbai. And I just want to point out one of the many aspects in which ICTP plays a role. We organized the Strength 2001 major international conference for the first time in India, first time in a developing country, actually. And I was one of the main organizers, and ICTP was the immediately came forward with 25,000 or 40,000 to fund this conference, and which is what made it possible to uphold it. So ICTP has had a huge impact on India, this I know. Something like 10,000 Indian scientists have visited our center over the years, and we have motivated maybe 15 million euros directly in terms of giving them the support for travel and so on to India scientific community.
Yeah, something I actually noticed in those years visiting the ICTP was how many outstanding Indian physicists would be visiting the ICTP in the summers. And I think it made a real difference, because during the following two decades, India will emerge as one of the leading countries in the world in fundamental physics, at least in quantum theory and string theory, the areas that I'm working in TUFTS, which led to, as Atish has mentioned, hosting the Strings Meeting 2001. It wasn't just the funding, but by 2001, there was a big nucleus of leading string theorists in India. Many of them had grown up in part because of the opportunity to get exposed to the more of them in summers in YCEP. Probably also other times in Green Group, almost in the summers, the right, to physicists was in Green Group.
Thank you. So let me quickly give you a few numbers on ICTP. We have, over the year, every year we have something like 6,000 scientists coming from all over the world at different levels of their career, from students to professors. So over the years, more than 180,000 scientists are in. So it's a huge global community that ICTP has created from 188 nations. And about two-thirds of them are from developing countries, and they are fully funded by ICTP. So this is one of the core missions of ICTP. And but the remaining one-third come from the developed world, like myself going from Princeton, because the quality of the work done there is so high that is one of the best conferences in string theory I attended was at ICTP. So many as here, the Witten and Edward said, really importantly, quiz out the ICTP. So maybe if you want to say something more about Yash, Chris, come and say.
Well, something that really comes to mind is the intensity with which Abdul Salam was committed to ICTP. He really made such a huge effort creating him and nurturing him through those years. And unquestionably, a substantial cost to key points in his career to his scientific work, because he was so committed to it. And I think it's a miracle that something like the ICTP exists. Without that effort, if he wasn't there and trusted, so on then kind of, there wouldn't be anything like it in the world.
Yes, I think, Salam came from a small village in Pakistan, and he returned to Pakistan after his PhD in Cambridge with the idea that he would like to go back to his home country. But then he was very reluctantly forced to return because he could not actually come back to research. And that's what actually spurred him to create an international hub for science to end the intellectual isolation in the world. And coming from India, Salam has been a big inspiration, not only for his physics, but also for his commitment to global science. Because in many ways, I identify with him. I also came from a small village in India. I worked in high energy theoretical high energy physics, and I returned to the Tata Institute for Fundamental Research because I really wanted to make a contribution in science. And so, of course, India in 2000 is not the same as Pakistan in 1916. I'm not suggesting that the situations are the same, but in many ways, the challenges that are still present in different form, even in the BRIC countries and certainly in Africa. So after becoming the director, I had to ask myself this question that what does ICTP stand for in the 21st century? Do we really need ICTP? And I'm very convinced that the mission of ICTP is even more relevant today. And as Edward said, it's really a unique institution of this kind. There is no other ICTP. There are many great institutions, of course, who are very high within scientific research. In its role in this internationalization of science, how can I say look at very unique? So I basically had to ask this question of why and what, how, when, why do we really need ICTP? That was the first question. And what, in what way ICTP especially, and how can we make ICTP more impactful in the coming years? So I just want to give you three stories other than the US statistics, and it will convince all of you. These are recent stories, so it's not something going back to we should know of others. We should take inspiration from him, but not actually him. So I just want to give you these three examples, which will tell you that ICTP is not like funding agency or control center, but we really work at a minimum level. But just this summer, Rajiv Mamade is a brilliant student from Ethiopia. He did his thesis with me on quantum entanglement topography. Really enthusiastic young person, and he got he's now coming to MIT to do his PhD. And he has told me several times that with ICTP's training, he's prepared to go to MIT and take on his challenging subjects. Second example I want to tell you is really wonderful. It was very heartwarming. I was visiting Hamburg and a young woman came up to me and she gave me a gift. And she said that it was not for me. She said, please take this gift to Kate Shaw in ICTP. And Kate Shaw runs our Physics Without Frontiers program. She's an experimental physicist who worked at CERN. And she said, this young woman, that I'm the first woman from Afghanistan doing a PhD in theoretical higher energy physics in Hamburg. And it would have been impossible if the Physics Without Frontiers program in Kate Shaw had not come to Afghanistan. So this was really a wonderful example. So we've had now 10,000 students. This is Physics Without Frontiers is like our road show. And this is an example that goes to 40 countries. And many young scientists are inspired by this. The third example is Professor Narayan Adhikari, just to tell you that ICTP is about brain gain and not about brain drain. So he came to ICTP as a student. He went back to Nepal. He's now a professor, and he has created a whole community of hundreds of scientists in Nepal who keep visiting us, some of them associates. He's actually a Siemens. He was an associate. So Siemens Foundation has given us quite generously over the years on this very successful associates program, which allows people like Narayan Adhikari to keep the flame going in a place like Mumbai. So I think delivering on this very basic mission is itself a worthy goal. So I'm quite convinced that you did ICTP today. But maybe you want to say something about the...
Well, actually, last summer when I visited the ICTP, I was quite impressed with the students I had there. One of them, I think, is probably
Yes.
And not infrequently, undergraduates from various countries around the world write to me asking for advice about how they enter to graduate school. I always tell them, maybe you can get to graduate school in a great way, but an option you should seriously consider is the diploma program through ICTP, because I know the students who do well there are then, I think this is Hymns and Ponder.
Yes.
Students who do well there are then able to go to leading graduate programs around the world. And some of the young people of whatever age to apply to the diploma program didn't sell when we're now doing PhDs elsewhere.
Yeah, so Federica Cachazo, your collaborator, is in.
Oh, yes.
He came from Venezuela, then he went to Harvard, and Mandis as a basement chair in Perimeter. And he always says that without ICTP, one had been able to do this. So the second thing I want to say is that what is special about ICTP? I think it's an international UN organization. And as a result, we have the convening power through the political neutrality, which sometimes doesn't exist in Mumbai University. And this has made it possible. It has been a tremendous help in overcoming oftentimes complicated visa regimes. And, you know, ICTP is able to, just to give you one example, climate response is going to be a challenge that all of us recognize. And even the Himalayas is like just going the boundary condition for our real Stokes situation. Chinese climate scientists and Indian climate scientists and Pakistani climate scientists could not visit each other. And one of the 10 years ago, I think Jagdish Shukla is here, and I'm a climate scientist who worked with ICTP. They came to ICTP first, and that's when the dialogue between climate scientists from China and Pakistan and India take place. So this is kind of a unique role of our center. So I think, and there are many examples that I can use when this role will become even more important. So now I want to come to what ICTP should look like tomorrow. Maybe, Claude, if you want to say something about that.
I think the need is clear because there, in so much of the world, the kind of scientific development that's needed in the modern world has to happen. There's Africa, there's even much about America and Asia have long been good. And even in India, India has achieved a very, very high level of some areas of physics. But you met how areas where there's a long time belief in India.
Yes.
So the mission of the ICTP is clearly still a vital aid with similar.
Yeah, I think I really feel that because even though India is a big country, if you go, when there are a number of very excellent centers around this country, the need for a place like Witten is very big. But there is also another aspect that I was thinking about, and we discussed this with our scientific council, because now we realize, a fragile institute that has recognized this even very sharply, that there is really going to be a new paradigm of doing science over the coming 10 years. Computing and machine learning and quantum computing and artificial intelligence is just going to explode. And I'm a pencil and paper theorist, but I recognize that unless it's really an obligation for ICTP to make these kinds of intellectual resources available for the whole world, because otherwise the knowledge divide is just going to be even greater. And I don't think we can afford to have a few private companies in the area having a monopoly over this enormous intellectual resource. So with that, the way I look at it is that, normally people, when they talk about open science, that's, say, at the time of Salam, it meant open access to information and journals. But I think open science is going to mean more and more open access to computational resources in data science. And this is why some of the new initiatives that we are thinking about, and Corinne was here, she was talking about it, we started an international consortium for scientific computing. So it is a consortium. So for example, we signed a memorandum of understanding that the South African government, the minister was present, Brazil, and also Chineca is one of the biggest supercomputing facilities in Europe. And Flatiron is also a clear partner when we can think of ways in which we can partner with Flatiron in this respect. So the idea is to create this consortium of scientific computing to meet the computational resources available. We have a very strong domain expertise at ICTP in many fields. So we need to build that core. So basically we need to create this build a core and also make it broadly available. So I think both these things have to be done. Then we are looking into an international master's in collaboration with the United Nations University. So for a student like Raji, if he goes to MIT, of course MIT recognizes ICTP's quality. But if he went back to Ethiopia, the diploma degree from ICTP doesn't count. So we want to gain this United Nations. And the new rector of the United Nations University is very keen to include the science So if we can very easily, we have about 100 students now, and I think there is great need, and I can easily see in doubling ICTP to 200 students. This is a completely no-brainer. And we have the capacity to sort of step up in all these areas. These are the two things that I'm looking at. And finally, I want to say, I think there is a much greater need now, with even as great a need now as it was before, for this international community of scientists. We have a number of examples currently, many scientists from Afghanistan, from Iran, from various parts of the world, scientists and tourists, Russia and Ukraine. The first 40 years of ICTP were, in fact, this East-West bringing together East and West. Now we have been more oriented towards South, but I really do believe that there is a greater need to be connected more to the East even today. I have a number of very disciplined people even I live in Slovenia. I had a personal connection to Slovenia, but I see that the Balkans and many universities there will benefit more from us. And we currently, for example, our associates program extends more towards the South, but perhaps we could extend it very easily to the East. So I think there are many such we have very good ideas, and we have to do this. Yeah. Thank you very much. If you want to add something, you have your
turn. I think we've covered most of the innovations. I'll just make a free cue by saying that Swalve always spoke about how the Int'l model needed to advance in both the level of cosmic sciences and the more practical sciences. So by the cosmic sciences, we include in particular astronomy and particle physics of oil and the practical sciences speaks for itself as philosophy of evolves that and you should advance all areas of knowledge to become truly strong and long endeavors.
Yes, and I think this point also comes across very often. I think there is no shortcut as Euclid to Ptolemy, there's no royal road to geometry, there is no royal road to technology. And we see this quite often. We get hundreds of applications for a course on artificial intelligence in Africa, but only maybe 10 of them are properly trained. Hit the necessary background in mathematics and statistics and physics and so on. So I think it's really important that a country has somebody who understands quantum mechanics before you think about quantum computing. So I think striking this balance is very important. And of course, I realize coming from India, there are always competing trade-offs to them, but it's important to emphasize along the science as much as folk. Thank you.